connects both Port and Washington streets in what would be the 500 block of Port and 500 block of Washington. Also the old post office building, what is the status of that? So there are some really key downtown buildings, 601 Penn Street. I'm assuming you were alluding to that earlier, that you know who has purchased it but are unable to discuss that at this point.
That is correct, yes.
Okay. And then finally, the Reading Eagle building. I'm concerned about the developers who both own the Eagle and the Madison, that they sit there without any movement, and whatever we can do to facilitate that.
I share your concern, but like I said, there are certain things that we need to help the developers to come with and be able to facilitate for them. This administration has been since January of 2020 working very hard to actually fight blight. Blight did not take place yesterday. It took place in years in there, and we are trying to do everything we can to bring in these. But the Bear building, for instance, the one you have, I worked with the developer in there. It doesn't have even levels in there. So it.
I'm very familiar with that building. Yeah. I've worked there for 23 years, so I know it inside and out.
So you know it better than I do, but these are some of the challenges that we have.
But my concern is when we have these large buildings, and I'm not sure exactly what we can do other than require that people pay their taxes, people keep them up, but the fact that they are sitting speculatively is of extreme concern. They're bought for pennies on the dollar. And then the hope is, well, something will happen and they can make enormous profits off of them, whether they rehab or not. I'm not sure how living in a capitalist society, we can do a whole lot about it, but we can do what we can do to make sure that they don't pull the city down. That if they are sitting there in speculation, that we don't have bricks falling into the street, that we don't have buildings, the paint coming off of them, things like that. Dumpsters sitting outside and getting, you know, piled up. I think there are very proactive things we can do, and we have to have a strong property maintenance and codes department to do that. I mean, you know, we get concerned about homeowners and distressed homeowners, and it seems that sometimes we're tougher on them than we are on these corporate types. And yeah, we want them to come to Reading, but I don't think we should allow ourselves to be played for fools and letting this flight go forward. And no, it didn't just happen in the last year, but it's on our watch now. And that's where we're at. So we're not going to have development unless we show that we have enough pride and enough energy to demand that everyone plays their role. And these folks who own these places and can do it, that at least they scrape paint and repaint minimally on Penn Street. It's just so frustrating. We see some of these large buildings that could be beautiful and, you know, that they've got enormous tax credits in the 1980s. Mm-hmm. And now they have just been left to wallow and fall apart. I just can't understand why we aren't standing there and screaming in front of the buildings saying enough is enough.
Thank you, Donna. Jamal, I want to be cautious of our time this evening. Clearly, you continue to see how passionate the council body is in the work that is placed on your shoulders. I will keep my comments very brief, and then I know we're scheduled to meet, so I can really expand in person with you. I think tonight, what's really important and what you can continue to do is to really define and explain not only to the council body, but to the public at large, how delicate of a balance it is for the city as an entity to work with private developers, where we can push them, where we can encourage them, and where, if necessary, we have to penalize them in the best interests of the city as a whole. And I think, too, that some of the complexity is within the multiple partners, perhaps, is the right word. You know, maybe resources at your fingertips, you know, the public-private partnerships, You know, there's a new level of complexity because the redevelopment authority is now within the city. But even alluding to one of the comments that Johanny made, I know that there are areas where a courtyard is owned by the redevelopment authority, but sometimes public works, you know, so multi-interdepartmental, inter-authority agreements that have always provided some difficulty in terms of just saying this person is responsible, right? So navigating that, I'm sure, is difficult. And as always, you know, hoping that you will turn to us as council body to request the resources that you need. You know, capacity is an ongoing issue, and we understand that. As you start to navigate through that, you know, we hope that you will approach us and say, here's what I need to be more efficient or to resolve some of the issues that are ongoing. I think Stantec has presented to us something that maybe had a little bit of an overtone tonight, even in the housing and maybe even hotels, right? I remember housing and hotels together. When we're talking about housing, we're hearing it over and over again. We're hearing housing mentioned in Berks County. We're talking about housing. Your incredibly deep dive on the economics of housing, you know, and residential versus commercial is appreciated, but, you know, helps us realize that, you know, where are we prioritizing? I think when Johanny asked the question of what is the vision, right? Do we have things that are guiding us so that when we present these to the public, to developers, to the people at large, we have a vision and we have our strategies ahead of us. I think as long as you continue to regularly update us and present us, you know, with those, with the timelines that were requested, and some other things that were brought up, and we can continue to help you do the best job possible, you know, to continue this development of our city in a great way. So I think we could spend hours talking about this. I will invite you back many, many, many times, and encourage my fellow counselors to reach out through the managing director and to you to discuss some of their deeper concerns and issues with you.
Because, and if I may.
Yes.
When I thought you were wrapping it up, I wanted to chime in a few words myself. So let me know when you're wrapping it up.
Go ahead, Mayor.
Okay, so first of all, I just want to thank Ms. Abdallah for an amazing and very detailed presentation on where a lot of development is currently going. I believe that definitely shows how proactive this administration has been in taking the initiative to downtown. Unfortunately, you know, we had this little thing called COVID that has gotten on the way on some of the items. You know, it shows that we're willing, ready, willing, and able to work with any developer and expedite the appropriate documentation and permits to move forward. I also want to thank Councilwoman Reed for reminding us that this is an issue that has been going on for years. You know, she mentioned 10 years. I would dare say that probably even a little bit longer. But for the fact that, you know, in the last 2 years that we've been in within this administration, and a lot of development has been going, even though it hasn't come to fruition in this totally, but it has started even through a pandemic. It just shows our engagement. I also wanted to chime in real quick in regards to the halls or areas where there potentially be some homelessness ongoing. We definitely are on top of it, talking with different agencies to make sure that we do what we can in a very respectful manner. As Jamal acknowledged, we're going to definitely bring it back up to the attention of Public Works, just to make sure that everything is being, an eye is being kept on. So just wanted to chime in and say thank you to Ms. Abadalo and everyone who has commented, especially reminding the public that this has been something ongoing for many, many years. And yet this administration is gonna take a very proactive approach to make sure that development goes on as quickly as possible.
Okay, thank you, Mayor, and thank you, Jamal. We're going to move on. We still have two topics left on our agenda. We have them designated for 20 minutes each, but I think we're going to try to abbreviate them 10 to 15 minutes. And the next is our passenger rail update, which I know is significant to the downtown development that we're discussing, would definitely have an impact. So Jamal, I think you and the managing director, Abe, will be discussing this. If you can be mindful of our time, try to make it a little more concise than maybe what you had originally anticipated, please.
Certainly, let me kick it off. First of all, good evening, councilors. It's good to see everybody. And as everybody knows, the topic of passenger rail service has been something that's been ongoing. We are closer than ever to making that a reality. And many of you know that a Tri-County Committee, Berks, Chester, and Montgomery County, was created back in February of 2021. And there was talk about a service expected to use Norfolk Southern-owned lines from Norristown to Reading, SEPTA-owned lines from downtown Philadelphia to Norristown. And there was an initial timeline for the committee to take action, 6 to 9 months. So we're in that time frame right now, and the work will continue. There is a very important meeting that's going to take place tomorrow evening at 6 o'clock. But in conversations with the council president, he wanted a presentation this evening to bring you up to speed, knowing that that meeting is going to take place. And if you haven't received an invitation to that for tomorrow via Zoom, please let me know. I'll be sure to I'll be sure that you have a copy of it so you can tune in if you wanted to. And of course, this is seeking a federal and state funding to develop what is known as a comprehensive study based on a PennDOT 2020 study that supports the restoration of passenger rail. So I know that Jamal just finished a tremendously comprehensive presentation, and I'm certain that you'll find this one just as informative. So thank you.
Thank you, Abe. Council, let's see, can I start now? May I?
Please go ahead.
Thank you. I just want to share with you something on a very, very light note. Back in the day when I sat in my parents' house in Kuwait playing Monopoly, honestly, I never thought I would be speaking about a train station in Reading, and I'm working for the city of Reading. But I am privileged and honored to share with you this information here. So the feasibility for studying railroad or passenger rail from New York, from Philadelphia to from Reading to Philadelphia and vice versa, and then extending beyond that to New York and Washington, D.C., was studied probably several times. Why is it so special this time? What happened in there? If you look at the history of the city of Reading itself, it's like similar to any other industrial cities, cities within the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and outside of that, with the collapse of the industrial market, as we knew it back in the 50s and the 60s, talent starts migrating, skills and professionals. And as a result of that, when we start losing these highly paid individuals, unfortunately, the economy starts eroding, and as a result of that as well, with the third step to it was that the decline of the property values. Reading continues to be isolated. Why is that? The commuter air services is absolute at this point in time. Reading used to be connected to Philly and other major cities, and that is not a service that we can rely on. The bus services that used to connect us to Manhattan is no longer as frequent and as available. And then we basically have highly congested streets. So in 2019, Berks Alliance retained the services of transportation and management systems. They go by TEMS. They are in Frederick, Maryland, to actually evaluate few parameters. Is there a market for passenger rail? Can we use that to travel from Philadelphia to from Reading to Philadelphia and vice versa? What are the routes that we can look at? Can we go to Lancaster and then down to Philly, or can we gather more collective route through Norristown and from there? what are the possibilities of inner cities and the like? And then if all of this can be a possibility, what sort of financial and economical impact it would have on our community? So Tim's study, the very first three options, the very first one was actually from Reading to Philadelphia, and then rely on the existing transportation to whether go to New York or to actually Washington, D.C. But options two and three would actually go from Reading to Philly, and you can continue straight to New York, or from Reading to Philly, and you can continue to Washington, D.C. These studies, these options were evaluated simply because Tim's study was based on the fact that they would like to make this investment as self-sustained and does not really need any government support or substantiation for fundings itself. There are two studies that were conducted almost in the same time, the one by PennDOT as well as the one by Tim's, and both studied the infrastructure. PennDOT required a third rail, whereas Tim's request said, no, we can use the Norfolk Southern. They both evaluated the equipment and the train technology, because when you see in the next map in there, you'll find out that when we get to Norristown, we have to switch from diesel to electric driven vehicles in there. So in general, the study that Tim's prepared indicated that a passenger rail from Reading to Philadelphia is a viable option itself. And to continue that on the near, in the Northeast corridor is also a viable, and they could do this with a very competitive rate. However, there are two important conditions, and that is you really need to, or we really need to bring in Norfolk Southern in the discussions from the very, very early stages within there. And we really need to take into consideration the PennDOT study that was done in 2020 as well. On these premises itself, the commissioners from Berkshire County, Chester County, Montgomery actually developed a tri-committee. And the tri-committee was formed, as Abe indicated, in February of 2021. At that point in time, they really wanted to have, as the study in such a way that from Reading to Norristown, we will use Norfolk Southern Rail, but from Norristown to Philadelphia, we will use the SEPTA rail itself. And as such, what would that happen to the coast itself, and how would that be able to? The committee have put a timeline of 6 to 9 months to complete the study. We are right now actually outside 6 months, but we are on target to move on to this. And they are looking for financial support from government, from federal, as well as state, as well as looking at basically outside private supporters as well. So this is the map that we have, and basically it shows that the rail passage is going to go through to Birdsboro, Pottstown, Royalford, and then into Norristown. It will actually stop at Valley Forge, King of Prussia, and that makes it more feasible. And then at that point, it will switch to the SEPTA lane that will take it all the way down to Philadelphia. On that, basically the action plan that was put by the Tri-County Commissioners was set with and informed by very bright individuals with the planning commission, with the planning from the counties itself, where they actually studied all possibilities itself. They also include the financial and political supports, legal and any other committee that they can, subcommittee that they can actually help to make this study a very reliable study and to see whether this is a success or not. So what comes out of it is that actually we would like to have a service, direct service from Reading to Center City, Philadelphia. And that was one of the missions that they have studied very carefully. A minimum of 3 trips a day, round trips to 12 preferably. And they are looking at the capacity of the rail to make sure that this can happen itself. And then at that point in time, would there be any stops in Phoenixville, Pottstown, as well as any other destination there? The planners County planners have actually developed the spath itself. And in this spath, as it's created, and you can see why they stopped on all these plates and these and there, the statistics in this area here, it shows within this area, there are more than 50% of the household people are considered low to moderate income. 50% or more. There are also about more than 30% who lives in this map here are people of color. And about 7% or more, age 16 and older, that they don't have vehicles. So understanding these statistics, planners actually kind of like moved into the next phase, and that is they started discussions and engaged with SEPTA as well as Amtrak. SEPTA offers more frequent stops, and actually it's more reliable in terms of the cost because it's subsidized by the state, whereas Amtrak, as you can probably, if you go on their website, you'll find out that they have actually announced a plan of serving Reading to New York as well as Philadelphia. That is on their website if you go there today in there. And they are benefiting from the Biden boost for the public transportation plan that is now being initiated itself. In addition to that, one of the things about Amtrak is that it runs inner city in another sense. It will not make the stops that we were hoping and expecting in our plan itself. But there is also a third option, and that is to have two services by SEPTA and Amtrak all together. So with that in mind, basically, they start looking at the funding process itself, or where the funds are going to be. And we mentioned and spoke about President Biden's plan for boosting public transportation fundings. There are also funds, and thank you, Mayor, for reaching out to the governor in support of passenger rail. That went very, very well, and we have received a lot of support from PennDOT for that matter. Thanks again, as well as actually what we are looking at, how we are going to use these funds. So there will be some capital investments as well as operations. When you have an authority, you will have staff, you will have operation expenses. Even in the beginning of it, there will still be a lot of expenses to that. In addition to this, actually, as you heard Abe saying, and I encourage you to join us tomorrow night at 6 o'clock in the evening. I will forward the link to Linda if she doesn't have it yet, so that basically can pass it on to you, where we will actually, you will listen to Commissioner Lineback and Dave Hunter speaking about their effort altogether. And we are trying to raise funds through the public, through municipalities. But also with all of these funds and grants, we still need in need of private funding. So how can we get private funding?
Jamal, excuse me for 1 minute. Sorry. I want to know how many more slides you have.
About four.
About four more. Okay. Four. Let's do 5 more minutes because this is a great a briefing. I'm hoping that council members will be able to tune in and attend tomorrow. So about 5 more minutes, please.
Yes, absolutely.
Thank you.
I'll speak a little bit faster and rumble a little bit more. But at any rate, so what we are trying to do here with that is basically create what's called Transportation Revitalization Improvement District. The Transportation Revitalization Improvement District, just like the CRIS, this is TRID, what it does is that it gives you a span of about 3/4 miles, both sides of the track, in which you will be able to create the TRID. One advantage to the TRID is the matter of fact that the properties will go up in value, and as such the tax will be assessed on a higher level. And there, the funds for the increase in the assessed tax will actually help securing a public bond that's payable in 20 years. I'm going to stop at this point here, but before I do so, I would like to indicate that my sincere thanks to John Weidenhammer and Dave Myers, who helped me preparing this proposal and this presentation altogether. Again, I'll be more than happy to take questions, but at the same time, I respect the time that's been allotted to me. So if you need any more information, I will be more than happy to forward this presentation to you all. Thank you.
Thank you, Jamal. I think it would be wonderful to forward this presentation to us. I think that everybody who can tune in tomorrow should do so. Of course, thank you for acknowledging the work of the Brooks Alliance, who really were the first to move this, pick it up, move it forward, and keep it going. You know, after tomorrow's presentation and with a thorough review of these slides, I think then maybe we can invite you back to ask some more questions after tomorrow's meeting, which really indicates how do we move this forward and what's the right plan. Just quickly, I'm happy to see the TOD on there, because I think one thing that we need to really pay attention to is setting the parameters so that when the train gets here and the development occurs, we are controlling what is happening. We are holding green spaces and spaces for public use that are critical, and we don't see development take over to a point where it's detrimental and displaces our community that's here. So I'm glad to hear you're looking into that. And I hope everybody does tune in tomorrow. After that, we'll probably be back in touch and have a lot more questions. So thank you.
And because of our effort, actually, we will have a seat at the table with the author, in the authority itself.
Very critical. So we wish you luck, as well as David Hunter and Commissioner Leinbach tomorrow, and those others from Brooks County who will be representing our county and the Tri-County Authority that's being formed. So that being said, we're going to move on to the deconversion incentives, which will be the last agenda item for this evening.
And thank you, Councillor. I just want to put something out for the consideration of the body, and out of respect for our time and the fact that we're still going to executive session. Would it be the pleasure of the council for this presentation to be made next week rather than tonight? I see some heads. I'm offering that as a courtesy and out of respect you and members of the public.
Yes, I appreciate that. Donna?
Very good.
Yes.
Everybody else okay with that?
Yes.
Good. Yeah, this is a very important matter. So is the rail. You know, everything tonight really has been in good context, and it's been in response to what we've been saying, and I can't appreciate that more.
Very good.
Thank you, Managing Director. So with that, any very important general comments that council members need to make prior to exiting into our executive session? Okay, and Fred, just before we go into executive session. Oh, sorry. Marcia?
Well, let me make a real brief one, and then I know Johanna had. I had just spoken with Council President, and I felt when we bring on our council solicitor, I think an item that needs to be addressed with all council members is maybe just a review of Robert's Rules of Order and the Administrative Code, so we all are on the same page when we're moving forward to conduct meetings. And it hasn't been something that we've had a chance to do recently. And I would suggest maybe we can do it when we have our new council members, but I just feel it's absolutely essential. So I just want to add that the council president supported me on it, so I'm hoping we all can move forward with that as an important piece of our work.
Thank you, Marcia. I agree. Johanny?
I just want to, oh, this is loud. Hold on. Can you hear me?
Yes.
I hear an echo.
Yeah. Johanny, you're on mute now. No, there's two of you.
It's because, because one, I can't hear anything. Hold on. There we go. Okay. Everyone can hear me now, right?
Yeah.
I wanted to give a quick shout out to Sergeant Fegley. I had the honor, the privilege to go and do outreach Thursday night from 11 p.m. to 2 a.m. I went out with the crew, with the homelessness, the Coalition to End Homelessness, with Hope Rescue Mission, the Reading Tower Street Medicine Team. Daphne from the Recreational Rec Commission was out there. There was another gentleman out there. But the shout out goes to Sergeant Fegley because I saw him in action dealing with our homelessness population, and he does it with so much care, compassion, and so genuine. I was really impressed and admired the work that he does. And I have to say that at the beginning of our walk, you know, I asked the question, well, how do we help our community? How do we help these people that are out here? And he really said, oh, that's, you know, that I leave it up to these organizations to do the work. But yet he actually was doing the work and really had so much patience in handling our population and managed to convince one of the homeless women who was out there to actually get into the Hope Rescue Mission to be escorted to the hospital. There's a lot of work to be done, people. I mean, it did break my heart to see what I saw walking out during the evenings. And we need to prioritize and make some time to figure out real solutions, right? We can't help people that don't want to help themselves, but especially the buildings that we own, there's a lot of camping out at. So I just wanted to put it out there. The next outreach is going to take place October 21st at 11 p.m. We meet at the state lot. Like, I want to continue to keep going out. I was really impressed being done, and I want to figure out how we collectively can do more and help more and really solve some of our Wow, kudos to the work that he is doing. I was very impressed. So I just wanted to put it out there. Thank you.
So a round of applause and recognizing Sergeant Fagley, and thank you, Johanny, for that. All right, so Fred, before we go into executive session, can you just give a brief comment to the public on the state of the executive session? Can't hear you. The nature and the need.
Yeah, this is a litigation matter. A pending ongoing litigation.
Okay, thank you. So at this time, then, we're going to ask Linda to dismiss everybody except who needs to be on the call for the executive session on pending litigation. And thank you, everybody, for tuning into the Committee of the Whole. A lot of good stuff tonight. A lot of good stuff.